All right. We are not going to be in Exodus 20 this morning. I know you're disappointed. We're never getting out of Exodus 20, but we are going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. So if you can turn there with me. Well, what a week we've had this week. I liken this week to me felt like, we're getting close to winter here. So, if you want to make hot chocolate and you want to do it right, you get your milk out, you put it in a pot and you put it on the stove, you turn the heat on. Make sure you watch it because milk responds differently to heat than water does, right? And so if you've had this experience, you know exactly what I'm talking about. There's this thing called the boil over that when the heat sits there long enough underneath that pot, suddenly, without any warning, just that thing froths and it's everywhere all over your stove. This is my experience of making chocolate milk. Yes, firsthand experience, absolutely. And that's what this week felt like for our country. It feels like there are issues that have been sitting on the fire for quite some time now, and suddenly a boil over, just a mess everywhere, and explosive responses, emotional responses, people on opposite sides, various sides of issues, were launching out, crying out. So given that, I didn't feel like we could move on just to a message that frames some thoughts from the book of Exodus. I felt like we needed to bring God's word to bear on our current situation. And so I'm going to do a part two. If you weren't here last week for exiles and elections, this is the next follow-up to that message called Exiles After Elections. It's a bit of a part two of where we are. But let's be realistic, and I want to be realistic this morning. There are issues in our world, aren't there? Right? There are issues of race in our world. And we've just heard a gazillion thoughts about race and how it should and shouldn't be handled, inequalities, historical perspectives on race that are sitting in our country right now. They're volatile, they're emotional, they're affecting people differently. There are issues of immigration being discussed, and how do you treat people coming to this country that's got such a prolific history of welcoming people from other lands to be a part of this melting pot? And every one of us has relatives or descendants that weren't from here. Unless you're Native American, you got ancestors that came over here, and they came from somewhere. And somehow they became part of this melting pot of a nation. And how do we deal with those folks and how we relate to them? There's issues of government, what role government should play, how big of a role should it play, taxation issues, there's economy issues. And that, economy issues are biblical issues in some ways because God is into families being able to provide for their families. And so what impacts jobs impacts your ability to do that. There are pressing issues of religious liberty in this country. As laws are being changed and Supreme Court folks who make these laws are put in a position to do things that maybe weren't legislated, but they're going to become laws and they're going to put limits and they're going to affect various religious groups and people with convictions and how they can and can't live out their lives. And this stuff is before us, sitting on the heat, about to boil over. If it hasn't boiled over for you already, perhaps it already has. But that's what our week has been like. And there have been debates and disagreements. And let me just say, the church has not escaped being in those debates and disagreements. I've seen some rather heated articles between Christian brothers, people who we would respect, many of them, who teach in the body of Christ, who are pastors and leaders in the body of Christ, who come to this week with the news of this week, with very different perspectives and feel differently about the outcome. Some of those are just a matter of how someone reasons through who to vote for, who not to vote for, what's the fallout of voting for one person versus another one. And some people had very strong feelings in one category, and some had strong feelings in another. And next thing you know, they're taking shots at each other, and there's strong presentations. There was quite a bit of racial concern within the body of Christ. You know, there was a huge divide on Tuesday in how black and white thought, and within the church, thought about this election. And I don't know how accurate some of these statistics, I've lost any sense that polls really know what they're talking about. Polls should hold up buildings, apparently, and not have anything to do with opinions. But if these observations and statistics are correct, the statement of 81% of white evangelicals voted in support of Donald Trump. And in comparison, a very, very small number of black evangelicals voted for Donald Trump. So you've got people of faith who come to issues like this and see some things that are very, very different, have passions about them in very, very different ways, right? I'm not fans of these folks. I'm going to quote some of these folks theologically, but they do represent people in the body of Christ who are looking at a situation that may be seeing some things differently than how you saw them or I saw them. In the Huffington Post, it says, Soon Chang Ra, a professor of church growth and evangelism at North Park Theological Seminary, said he felt a, quote, profound disappointment that a candidate that has rejected Christian values and attempted to marginalize people of color has received the support of the American people. I knew that America could never, ever lay claim to being a Christian nation, but any pretense of America holding to Christian values has just gone out the window. All right, let me just tell you what I'm not going to do in this message today. I'm not going to equally represent one view and another, left and right, etc. I don't have time to do that. But I do have to just point something out in these sorts of statements, which is a challenge for us because we're all reading these statements and we're trying to digest what they mean. But when someone says these things just went out the window, I'm just wondering what have you been staring at for the last 20 years, right? So I realize Donald Trump is a lightning rod, and I want to get us to think fairly about our convictions, because I want the Bible to bring our convictions to task, right? That's my job. I'm not a social media person. I'm not a commentator on a news channel. I'm responsible for the body of Christ here in this local church and the way in which we think biblically. So there are issues here. And for anybody in this church, black, white, or different color, for you not to have noticed that this is not new, that this country has been departing from Christian values, this didn't just happen on Tuesday. Okay, this was happening drastically under President Obama as well. And you might like him for some reasons, and you might like Donald Trump for some reasons, but don't anybody think for a second that what Christianity defines as moral, as godly, as honoring of authority, to think that hasn't been affected in the last several years is to ignore some things. So this is not new, but yet here's a Christian writer who's acting as though something happened Tuesday that's new. That's not new. Brian McLaren, a Christian author and speaker, told Huffington Post that he's disappointed that the majority of his fellow Christians, quote, supported a man who used racism, misogyny, Islamophobia, and other anti-Christian strategies as an election strategy. He hoped that younger generations will forge a new path. I hope that younger generations of evangelicals will turn away from the leaders their parents followed in voting for Donald Trump, and find a new and better way to be Christian. So their politics will be driven less by greed and fear and more by love, McLaren wrote in an email. I hope that white evangelicals will come to terms at long last with the racism and religious prejudice that are deeply embedded in the evangelical tradition, often at levels evangelicals aren't aware of. All right, well, this is a, I would not support Brian McLaren's theology, but he claims a conversion experience and a relationship with Christ, and he sees these issues through whatever lens sits inside of him. And this is how he feels about these elements. Christianity Today quoted a professor from Calvin College and said, we are going to see continuing rifts among evangelical leaders in the coming years. And much of the debate will be about how to respond as Christians to the many challenges of pluralism in American public life. Well, pluralism and its rampant rise in our culture is kind of new to us. We're a very monolithic group that came over and gotten some boats and came over to this country with a set of ideas that were pretty similar to each other in a lot of ways and tried to make a nation happen. And over time, that's changed quite a bit. Now, I want to send you back to a message that I did during the summer on political diversity and church unity, because it'll cover some things that I don't have time to cover today. But we're learning some lessons that the first century had to figure out how to be together in the body of Christ with such diversity of experience and background in the Roman culture, where people were so different, slaves and free, Jews and Gentiles, class structures, and they all came together into the church to be about a mission that God had joined their hearts to when he saved them. And we're going to have to relearn that, because I see this polarizing impact that's taking place, and it's impacting the body of Christ. It's impacting how we relate to one another, how we prioritize people's convictions and who feels strongly about what and for what reason. And a lot of that is along racial lines. A lot of that is along moral lines. But I want to point us to something that's a little more important to us today. And I don't know how careful I'm going to be in what I say. I'll try. But there are some realities to the setting that we live in. And I think no matter where your loyalties are, I think it would be helpful for us to at least be honest about the realities. Right? So whether you're a person here who feels relieved that Donald Trump was elected president or terrified that Donald Trump was elected president, and there are both in the room. And I want to say this, you have a responsibility to the other group that you're not a part of, that exceeds your reasonings to land on a particular candidate. You have a biblical fellowship basis with that other person that is far more important than your political view and how you relate to them and what you prioritize in relating to them and serving them and caring for them. But without a question, right, this is what's on the field for us. President-elect Donald Trump, he is a polarizing, complicated figure. He's got views that are both toxic and decent. And it's going to be a real complicated thing to navigate that over the next several years as you and I interact with the leadership that comes from the White House. It's always been a challenge to interact with the leadership that comes from the White House. This is not new. But it's going to be a little bit different, and it's going to be a little bit different for the church. So I'm taking this moment to remind us, and we're going to find something here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm taking this moment to remind us. There are issues out there, right? There's a bunch of them. But there is an issue for the Christian that defines our lives, that wakes us up on Monday morning, and that determines for us how we interpret all the other issues. There is an issue. Now, there are issues out there, but there is an issue for the Christian that we're going to see in this passage today. And I think it might be a good, meaningful moment for us to get a little bit of a mission statement reminder. And what I want to leave every Christian with as you leave here today is keep your eye on the ball. Which has been a little tough to do this week, right? But let's see if we can figure out what the ball even is. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to read quite a bit of 2 Corinthians here. Starting in verse 1. For we know that if the tent that is our earthly home is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this tent we groan, longing to put our heavenly dwelling. Put on our heavenly dwelling, if indeed by putting it on, we may not be found naked. For while we are still in this tent, we groan, being burdened, not that we would be unclothed, but that we would be further clothed, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. He who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, right? It is necessary and it is frequent. And if you read the New Testament looking for this, you will see it all over the place, that the New Testament writers often felt the need to remind the audience, we are strangers here. We are exiles here. We are aliens here. This is not our home. And so we live in these bodies, but we are away from our home while we live in these bodies. We experience the Lord and his nearness at some level, but we long for more. And there's a ceiling on us in this world because we are not at home yet. And there's a place that we're going to where we'll be with the Lord forever, and we will see him face to face. And suddenly, these limitations will be stripped away from us, and then we will be at home. We will get a new home address. There will be mansions prepared and rooms made for us in the Father's house. We will get a glorified body that doesn't get subject to all the issues that we struggle with in these bodies here on this earth. But Paul has to remind us over and over and over again, you are not at home. This world is not your home. Candidates and policies, etc. This is not your home. And what's interesting is I hear Paul talking to these folks. As you guys remember, I think I covered some of this last week. This letter is written to the Corinthians in about 56 AD, which means they are in either year one or year two of a new emperor named Nero, who is going to turn out to be a cornflake, weirdo, bizarre nutcase. And they are going to be governed by him. And they are going to be subject to the threats and the fears that would come from a man who has treated his family in a particular way, right? Killing his relatives as it served him and seemed fit, creating bizarre activities amongst the people. And when the guy was just unstable, and he's the new emperor, and you've heard about this. And yet, Paul is able to say, but we are always of good courage. We are always of good courage. So no matter what you feel about this election, that statement is true. And it's true because you're not at home here. And whatever is happening here, there's a God who's governing it. He's the king over the universe, and everything, every government, every leader, every person who wears a crown and makes decisions is underneath his kingship. And this is not our home, and we will go to be with the king at some point in our lives, and we will be at home there forever with him. So therefore, we are of good courage. I keep reading in verse 7. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. Right? That's a governing statement for everybody here. If you belong to Christ, the aim of your life, the aim of every word that comes out of your mouth, every attitude that gets formed in my heart is to please him. That's my aim. Verse 10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. This is an interesting construct here. This is one that I think this sobers us. This brings us back to finding what's the ball we're supposed to be staring at as Christians. He reminds them of something here. He reminds them of something that, you know, in the day-to-day, paying bills, doing jobs, monitoring your health, going to the gym, running errands, it's really easy to lose sight of something. That at the end of our lives, every last one of us will stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Every last one of us. And there will be an accounting done like you have never seen, done in complete perfection, that is able to analyze every thought, every motive, every action that ever took place in our lives, and we will give an account as to whether that was good or evil. Kind of easy to lose sight of that, isn't it? In fact, you may be here this morning, and you may not have thought about that for a very, very long time. You may be living your life on a daily basis, running after whatever, choosing actions without that in sight. Choosing to prioritize certain things that you live for, choosing to behave certain ways, choosing to have certain elements and attitudes that are kept in the dark that no one knows about, only because you have overlooked and you have forgotten. There will be a day where everything hidden will be revealed. You might be one of the most smartly deceptive people that has ever lived, and you have fooled your wife, you have fooled your boss, you have fooled your children, and you hate the idea that they would ever find out the shame you will face. Can I just tell you, when you stand naked before the presence of a perfect God in all of his majesty and love and perfection, and this gets revealed, whatever you'd have felt in front of your wife or your children or your boss, it will pale in comparison. You will be stripped naked by the reality of what you chose to do with your life. I hope that disturbs you. Paul said, knowing this, verse 11, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. Listen, this is why Christians are in the persuasion business. Which, let me just raise that as a question. Are you in the persuasion business? Are you living your life in such a way that one of the primary things that you exist for is to persuade others to see the gospel? The way you live. The things that you're for. The things that you're against. The integrity of your life. What your life when no one is seeing you. Not just what you're like when you're here on a Sunday morning. Not just what you're like when you're in a small group and everybody's talking about Jesus. What you're like on social media. Is it your aim above all other things to persuade others? We as Christians are in the persuasion business. Yes, we are in the conversion business. Yes, I needed to get my life right with Jesus. I had issues that were wrong. I had sinful things. I was separated from God. I didn't like my life. I knew I needed some kind of internal healing and wholeness. But I am now given the role and responsibility to be persuasive of others. Every Christian has that. Listen, none of us have the privilege of creating a world where we have disengaged ourselves from the world. I know this is easy to get confused because, we hold as a high value purity and holiness and living our lives for the glory of God. And so part of that makes us want to retreat from the world, right? We want to be safe. We want to keep our hearts guarded from the ideas of the world. We want to keep our kids away from the ideas of the world. So we just retreat, and the church becomes a place where we retreat. But how can you retreat and be persuasive all at the same time? Because knowing the fear of the Lord, knowing that outside these walls are people who are going to stand, they've got an appointment. It's already on the calendar for them. That they will stand before God and give an account for their lives. Knowing that, Paul says, we are out there persuading people. We are engaging people's lives for the purpose of persuading them. I hope you'll consider this judgment seat of Christ, it awaits you and it awaits others. The people that you know in your life. The people that you had political conversations with this week. Something much bigger awaits their lives. Much more critical to their well-being awaits their lives. And you know it. Because you've read the Bible and you know it's true. So there's a responsibility for us to be persuasive in the lives that we live. Look in verse 14. Paul said, "For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised." It's an interesting thing here that we have. This will fill out your theology, right? Because there's some in the room here who have a burden that others would come to know Christ, and their burden lies in the love of God, right? They would say, I get that. I get how the love of God makes me feel. I get what it did for me, and I want people to know of the love of God. So I'm compelled, like this verse says, I'm compelled. The love of Christ, that word actually means controls and compels me. It sends me. It motivates me. It makes me move toward people with this ministry of persuading them. But can you see something that this is, the addresses of these two motivations are in the same passage? Knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade men, and knowing the love of Christ, we persuade them. And listen, you don't get to pick which one you like better. Some people love to start a conversation with, you know, hey, you're going to face God in judgment. And they're all over the judgment thing. You almost never hear them talk about the love of God. And then some people want to talk to people and persuade them about the love of God and never want to talk about the judgment of God. Can you just this is one Bible, and these two things are in the same passage together. So the Apostle Paul was launched toward people out of a concern that you've got an appointment with God and you're going to stand in judgment. And I am eager to persuade you for that day. And at the same time, he is compelled by the love of Christ to go to them and to share the gospel with them. In verse 16, "From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come." This is a radical, radical verse. That when Jesus was resurrected, this is why we know him no longer according to the flesh, because he went through the resurrection. In God's plan, even what we knew of Christ in his earthly ministry has been transcended by something even greater. So he sits in glory, seated at the right hand of God in a resurrected state. And he says, oh, by the way, you too have received this resurrection life inside of you. So you are a new creature as well. So we recognize no man any longer according to the flesh. Now, this is only true of Christians, by the way. It's been an interesting week this week, right? Strong opinions, people taking sides, Christians calling into question why somebody would do this and why somebody would do that. What do you recognize first or most when you look at someone else? What do you recognize first or most? Right? You know, these issues are all over the table for us this week, so maybe the first thing you recognize was that person's candidate choice. Right? That's what defined that person for you. And if they chose a candidate that you absolutely felt horrid about and can't believe they would do that, or that they've ever voted the way in which you think is just horrible, and they're Christians, is this what you did? You put a little distance between me and you. Because I can't believe you would think that's a good idea. Well, what did you just do? You recognize somebody, not according to the resurrection life that made them a new creature. You recognized and you determined your fellowship with them and your relationship with them based on something other than that. Based on their views of Muslims in America. I can't believe you think. What are you thinking? Don't you know they're going to blow us all up? How could you possibly? I need to back away from you. Or the real hot button, racial inequality. What do you do? When you're having a conversation with somebody who's got a different position than you do in that. You grew up one way, they grew up another. Your definitions and experiences and critical moments and things that really matter are one thing, and theirs are something else. And you raise the issue of racial inequality, and that person goes, it ain't all that bad. All that bad, and what do? I think we need to put a little distance between me and you. What are we doing in these moments, body of Christ? We are recognizing people according to the flesh and failing to see the resurrection life coursing in people's veins that was purchased by the blood of Jesus and by God bringing him to life and giving his life to us. There's something bigger about us than these things. Keep your eye on the ball. Well, let these passions and these things and these issues, and they're real issues, and I'm good with having an opinion about real issues, but be careful what they do to us. Look in verse 18. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Listen, if you're in this world trying to figure out who you are and what you are and what you're supposed to be doing and what's your life calling and what's your thing that you're supposed to find your niche and be something in this world. Okay, I get that. But this is a defining thing about every Christian. This defines every one of us. You have been employed in an activity. You have been given the ministry of reconciliation in which you go into this world, every corner of it, every color of it, with the motivation and the pronouncement in your heart that says, be reconciled to God. I'm here to tell you God has done something to break down the barrier. You don't have to be in your sin any longer. You don't have to bear its consequences. You don't have to bear its penalty. You can be reconciled to God. Let me tell you how you can be reconciled to God. If you're a Christian, that's the most dominant thing on the campaign trail that you've got to talk about. Nothing else comes close to that message in your life. And here's the real challenging part. I'm going to have to let my views on other things, politics, favorite sports team, whatever. I'm going to have to make sure I manage those things in such a way that I never damage or diminish my ability to persuade you of the gospel. By the way, this is true not just in political seasons. This is true when somebody cuts you off in traffic. Right? I mean, I stop and think that guy just cut me off in traffic. I don't know what it is about people cutting you off in traffic. There's just something built into the flesh that instantly you have to manage rage. I have no idea. You know, it just you just feel like, oh, how dare that person occupy the lane in front of me and go slow. I mean, it's just something that it rises up in me. But I always confront that with the thought that if I have a conversation with that person ever in the future, they walk in the back door of my church, I bump into them at Starbucks, whatever, have I done something to them, said something to them that will damage my ability to persuade them of the gospel? How many of you guys have experienced getting really bad customer service? In this day and age, everybody has experienced that. Whether it's a waiter in a restaurant who took forever, brought you the wrong stuff, had a bad attitude, and you kind of want to say something. Hey, I get that. Just remember, you have been entrusted with the ministry of reconciliation. So that the end of whatever it is that you're going to have to say to that person, are you going to be able to persuade them of the gospel? Or are they going to look at you like, you are an obnoxious human being. I don't want to hear anything you've got to say about anything. Well, that's been true in this political arena, hasn't it? So we're Christians and we engage the political process and we have dialogue with these issues. And when we're done having dialogue, question, have you damaged your ability to persuade others with the ministry of reconciliation? Because you've been entrusted with that. And those are eternal things, not four-year, who's in office for a little while issues. These are monstrously important issues. And we have obligations here to cross over our comfort zones with this because we've been entrusted with the ministry of reconciliation. So, if you're a white person, do you know that you have an obligation and a responsibility to build gospel bridges into black people's lives? Do you know you will stand and give an account before God? Maybe you were raised a certain way. Maybe you've got certain issues. Maybe you don't like the way the public is portraying the racial inequality issues and how that's getting managed in the public sphere. That's just not going to float with God when you've got to give an answer to having been entrusted with the ministry of reconciliation and you put walls around it and said, I won't go there. I won't relate to that person. I won't walk through that door. Listen, this cuts in both directions. If you're black, you don't have permission from God to just live amongst those who agree with you instead of building bridges into white people's world. White people who might not agree with you, might have different convictions about the history of this country and the way people were treated, etc. That is not a viable excuse for not taking the ministry of reconciliation and the persuasion of the gospel into the white world. It's true for Hispanic communities. It's true for every human being is an object of persuasion by the body of Christ. Every human being is to be affected by this ministry of reconciliation that we have been entrusted with. And these moments highlight kind of what keeps us from doing that. This verse goes on in chapter 5, verse 20. It says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Listen, this is the most gripping, most serious, compelling in the heart of a Christian. This side of heaven. This sense of urgency. We implore you to be reconciled to God. Why is that? Because I'm an ambassador of Jesus Christ. That ruler, that God-man sitting in the heavens, I'm his ambassador. Right, you got a little bit of an idea what an ambassador does? Most of us do. Right? Ambassadors aren't free agents. Ambassadors aren't in a country with their own ideas on their own behalf, feeling the way they want to feel about whatever, saying whatever they want to say about whatever. They've got a very simple job. They're an ambassador who represents that government. So whatever that government says, they say. Whatever that government is positive on, they're positive on. Whatever that government is negative on, they're negative on. Personally, it doesn't really matter what their feelings are. Because as an ambassador, they represent someone else. As an ambassador of Christ, you and I represent someone else. So, you know, it doesn't really matter what my personal opinion is about these issues that are all around our culture. It doesn't really matter what my personal opinion is. It doesn't really matter how I grew up, what color I am, what priorities I've created for this world to respond to. It doesn't really matter. I'm an ambassador for Christ. So what matters is how he feels about these issues. And my obligation is to get on his page. My obligation is not to get on anybody else's page. And I want to caution us as we move forward in the days ahead about who you identify with. Who have you yoked yourself to? Who have you connected yourself to? Because they share some views that you share as well. Have you become associated with people because they've got some views that are important to you? And you have now associated your life with them? Listen, you can do that in such a way that nobody knows anymore that you're an ambassador of Christ. They just think you're a representative of that. And guys, that just cannot happen. It cannot happen. All right, so let me share two cautions and concerns. One, be careful who you appear to be partnered with. Be careful who you appear to be partnered with, right? In this context, we move a little forward from this context. The context is Paul's passion for these exiles to be about persuading people with the ministry of reconciliation. That's his concern for the people. And you get to chapter 6, verse 14, and these are famous, taken out of context passages usually, where it says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. As God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Listen, God, not sure whether Donald Trump will ever build a wall or not, but God already built the wall. And he said, you be mindful that there are people that I don't want you partnering with. So that raises some interesting insights for us in the days ahead. Ken Hughes in his commentary on 2 Corinthians says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. That is, do not be allied with unbelievers as to their teaching or way of life or false worship. Be careful whom you appear to be partnered with. God has already said, you are my ambassadors. you're communicating my message, you represent me, you be careful who you partner your life together with. When I do these kinds of messages, there's only like 8,000 things that crowd in my head saying, well, you need to talk about that, and you need to talk about this, and if you talk about that, then you're going to have to talk about this. And so I'm going to say something, and I know I'm not going to cover all the edges and all the extremes of this and all the positions that you'd hope that I will talk about. But just listen. This is my opinion, right? But I think I'm informed by Scripture, trying to apply that wisely. Right, here would be my opinion. Donald Trump has lived a life and modeled an attitude that is immoral, demeaning, insulting, prideful, and appears very self-serving. His provoking comments to fellow candidates in the Republican primary were petty and childish. His multiple marriages and history of questionable comments, particularly with regards to women and behaviors, have created a persona that associates this man with darkness. His personality has presented a polluting element to a number of social issues and topics. When we, as God's people, attempt to speak into these topics, the culture will associate us with this polluting presence. And thus, all of our conversations have just become more difficult. I hope you can join me in some level of objectivity and agree at some level to what I just said. There are issues near and dear to the heart of God. There are important issues that touch the way people live their lives. And when you and I step into them now, there's somebody else standing in that moment. And he's already spoken about these things, and he has done so in such a way that have polarized people, have made them want to fight, have made them aggressive. And whether you agree with him on some of these positions or not, there are people that you and I need to have conversations with to be persuading them of the gospel, that our job just got harder. I am here as an ambassador of Jesus Christ. And it appears that this man has borrowed some of the convictions held by Christians to further his own ambitions. His statement in 2015 of not being able to recall a time where he needed to ask God for forgiveness is the worst proclamation of spiritual blindness that I've ever heard. I'm sorry, I just cannot imagine a human being with an ounce of self-awareness and any form of insight into who God might be wondering whether I would really need to even ask forgiveness. No, I'm not making that a practice. Even the worst of heathens typically stands up and says, well, I know I'm not perfect. I know I've got problems. This tells me, this is your view on forgiveness, that you have no true understanding of sin and righteousness or of the nature of man or the nature of God. Basic self-awareness of a need for forgiveness is fundamental to the gospel. His polarizing personality has associated our convictions with weapons of insult, with segmented interests that appear to be advancing the interests of one group at the expense of another. This is everywhere, right? And there are some really, really obnoxious people out there getting their say in public about things. But this is the tone of which we as the body of Christ are going to be fielding attitudes, right? Greg Popovich is the coach of the San Antonio Spurs. Thought he was into basketball. Apparently he's into social commentary as well now. He said, we live in a country that ignored all those values that we hold our kids accountable for. I look at the evangelicals and I wonder, those values don't mean anything to them? And I don't know the hard attitude behind some of those statements and what kind of hardness and anti-God posture some of these people are in, no matter what and who won and whatever. But this is the sort of confusion that has come in to the world that you and I are seeking to populate, not because we're trying to get a candidate in office, but we're trying to persuade men to be able to stand before the throne of God one day and give an account for their lives. And we are compelled by the love of Christ for them to be reconciled to God. And therefore, we speak on issues. We are ambassadors for Christ, and we speak on issues that the King has an opinion on. If you look there in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, there, verse 3, Paul says, "We put no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found in our ministry. But as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way." Listen, we are called upon in this ministry of reconciliation to be very careful in the attitudes that we carry, in the issues that we create, in the way in which we relate to people, because we don't want to create obstacles for the ministry of persuasion. We don't want to do that. So I've got to say, I believe associating the gospel ministry with Donald Trump is an obstacle. I believe it creates an obstacle. So can this is my opinion. But you're going to get asked questions in the coming days as a Christian. As a Christian who, according to the world, put this man in office, if you're one of the 81% of white evangelicals. And you're going to get an attitude from people when they ask you, so do you agree with Donald Trump on fill in the blank? On immigration? On this thing? On that reform? On this tax policy? On blah, 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 blah? So do you? Do you agree with Donald Trump on that? Can I just suggest something? You pray about how you should respond in that moment. My response is going to be, well, I don't know. Does he agree with Jesus Christ on that issue? Because I'm an ambassador for Jesus Christ. And so if he agrees with Jesus, then I guess we would agree. Because the real problem will be yoking yourself to this individual and trying to persuade people with the gospel, because his life and words and attitude have confused what the gospel really looks like and what it's really about and how it impacts human beings and whether it produces in us humility and an awareness of our own sinfulness and the greatness of God and a desire to bring our lives into conformity to the authority of Christ. I don't think people are going to be seeing that anytime soon from him. So I don't want to get dragged into a conversation that has, you know, I felt sorry for these people that are campaign managers and that he'd say some lightning bolt statement and then they put the microphone in front of their face and say, so what do you say about that? I'm like, oh my gosh, how'd you like to have that job? But I don't want to talk about this individual's perspective on things. If you want to talk about an issue, let's talk about an issue. You want to talk to me about abortion? Let's talk about abortion. And I will share what I believe is the perspective of my King for whom I represent. I believe Jesus would say this about that. You want to talk to me about immigration? Okay, I'm not trying to pick up and defend all the edges and oddities of somebody's foreign policy. I just want to represent what the Bible has to say about people in this world who find themselves in an immigration moment. And at the same time, I'm honoring the scriptures that talk about nations that are supposed to have borders to protect their people. That's a good thing. That's wise. There's a way to do that that's appropriate and godly. And then there's people in suffering and situations and need that, you know, the same Bible speaks to me about that too. So it's not quite as easy as some of these politicians make it sound and some of the positions make it sound. And my job is to find out what the King has said about these topics and not to let positions of politicians define my position, because I'm here to represent the King, and you are too. No matter what color you are, no matter what your convictions are, no matter what your preferences are, you and I are here to represent Christ. Russell Moore wrote an interesting article this week for the Washington Post. Russell would be a guy I would agree with. He says, the most important lesson we should learn is that the church must stand against the way politics has become a religion, and religion has become politics, Morrison. We are not first Republicans or Democrats, conservatives or progressives. We are not even first of all the United States of America. We are the church of the resurrected and triumphant Lord Jesus Christ. Our rallying cry is not hail to the chief, but Jesus is Lord. Perhaps this electoral shakeup means that President Trump will lead America to be great again. I hope so. But regardless, whatever happens to America, we must seek the kingdom first again as God's people. So in the days ahead, as lightning rods and statements are being said and views are being thrown on the table, be careful who you appear to be partnered with. All right, this race issue is such an enormous thing. And I have grown to appreciate the struggles of black brothers and sisters who have walk through the history that they've walked through, have experienced life in this country the way they have, who have relatives, who have memories. And I think there's an appropriate level of us as a white community getting that, learning to get that. I've gotten this in some rubs from people as I've tried to do that over the last year. White people rubbing me the wrong way. I'm going to take a risk now, and I'm going to let the black people rub me the wrong way. I did not sense a carefulness from many in the black evangelical community about their carefulness of being partnered with President Obama. Everything I'm saying to all the white people here about that guy, Donald Trump, who is the president, we're going to respect him, we're going to pray for him, we're going to hope for his success. But I do not want to be partnered with him in his views or his life or his practices or all of his policies. I want to be partnered with Jesus Christ. The black community in the body of Christ needed to have done exactly the same thing with Barack Obama to be able to say there are policies and views that do not represent me. And though I'm the same color as he is, I am not partnered with him. And I'm the same color as this white guy who's the president right now, and I'm not partnered with him. I'm an American. He is my president. And I'm going to pray for him the same way that it could be much worse, right? I could be reading 2 Corinthians 5 the day it was written and first given out. And I would be trying to figure out how to be an ambassador for Christ with Nero the freaky cornflake as my ruler. Maybe you think we've got our own cornflake. Maybe so. Be careful who you appear to be partnered with. You are an ambassador of Christ. Do not let any other partnership damage that. Secondly, be careful what you are angry about. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, in the same context, Paul says in verse 3, we put no obstacle in anyone's way so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But, verse 4, as servants of God, we commend ourselves in every way by great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, the Holy Spirit, genuine love. Be truthful, by truthful speech and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left. Be careful what you are angry about right now. What you are finding heat that wants to just foam over and suddenly, what people are most in touch with about you is how angry you are. you're a stranger and an alien here. You hold these issues so differently than those who have no hope beyond this world. What are you so angry about? White people are angry. Black people are angry. Latinos are angry. LGBT people are angry. Everybody's angry. But Paul started this group off saying, but we are of good courage. And we are in this setting with qualities like this, purity and knowledge and patience and kindness. Genuine love has infected the attitude that we have. James says, remember this, brothers, let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to be angry. For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. But I know anger just feels right, doesn't it? Just feels right. My button got pressed. My issue. You remember I said this in that message back in the summer about politics and unity in the church. Your anger may be giving away to you what you are partnered with. And you may be partnered with something at way too high of a level. Instead of recognizing my partnership was with Christ. So question, is your anger about to boil over on social media? Has your anger already boiled over on social media? Somebody said something, you responded, they responded, you responded. Nuclear missiles were going back and forth in cyber world. And then when you were done, my question to you is, did you damage or diminish your ability to persuade them of the ministry of reconciliation? Did that person listen to you and walk away scratching their head going, whoa. Thought he said he was a Christian. Now I get that they may not even know what a Christian really is. And that's going to be interesting in the days ahead. But can I just suggest to you bluntly, some of you don't belong on social media. And I have a hard time with this verse, being an ambassador for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you. On behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. And you just blew somebody up and said the most insensitive, stupid thing that could have ever been said, and you published it on social media. Excuse me, but what the hell are you doing? The defining thing about your life is you've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Do nothing to put an obstacle in the way of that. And if you don't have the self-control to not start typing after somebody says something stupid or imbalanced, or they just displayed their lack of awareness of the rest of the universe, if you don't have the self-control for that, get off social media. It's not worth damaging the ministry of reconciliation that you have been given. I don't know if you guys would be aware. You'll be aware of this if you put forth the effort to build bridges, I'm talking to the white people now, into the black world. You'll be aware of some of the insensitivities of things that you say in social media, of how it impacts them, of how it makes the black population that God has blessed us to be a part of this church with do this to you because they don't know how to take you now. Because you've said something that sounds just like those people that we've learned all of our lives hate us and are against us. And I was sitting in church with this guy, and then I read his social media publication, and he sounds just like them. And I don't know what to do with that. I thought we had fellowship. I thought we were together. But God, by his grace, has chosen for us to be a church that's growing in diversity, growing in diversity. Grateful to God for that. So we have black and Latino, Asian, growing populations among us. Can I just obligate every one of you? You have a responsibility to figure out who those people are and to make sure your behavior communicates love to them. But I don't necessarily agree with their views. I don't care. I don't see anything in the Bible that says you're called to genuinely love them once you agree with their views. Listen, we got it a whole lot easier than the first century church did. Slaves and free, Jews and Gentiles. I mean, I know the race thing looks like, oh, it's so out of control here. Listen, Rome was worse. And yet they were called to a love that was mind-blowing with one another, and we are called to that as well. So listen, if you don't know, sit down with somebody and find out. It was interesting for me to sit with a black brother this week and say, hey man, how'd you feel about Tuesday night's results? What did that do to you? How does that make you feel about the next 4 years? If you're a white person here and you got conservative values, you're kind of like, wow, was there a problem? Yeah, because some people who grew up feeling like those ideas and those values aren't for me, and they're not for my people, and they're not gonna further my good. They're gonna hurt me. They're gonna hurt my children. All right, now, whether you agree that that's true or not, that's how some people feel. And if they're part of this, listen, they're people in your family, right? They go through issues. Your kids go through issues, and you're an adult, and you see some things. You got some information that kid doesn't have, and they're freaked out over something. How do you treat that child? Hopefully with love and compassion from where that person is. Listen, on both sides of this issue, there are people who just have different perspectives because we were raised a certain way around certain ideas. You know how you manage that issue in the body of Christ? And I hope we can pull it off. And I commend, and I've done this before, and I've done it personally. I commend anybody who's joining us in fellowship who's black has come so much farther than any of us who are white to be in this church. Because they've got to cross all kinds of barriers and issues in the culture and things that they'll tell me the family members are saying because they're going to a white church. And they are here to join in fellowship around this resurrected Jesus. Right? So if there's a group here that I would say doesn't recognize people according to the flesh, there's some black people way ahead of some white people here. So we kind of need to figure out how do we do this as a church? And what I watched this week was polarizing. And it was polarizing because of a complicated issue of a man who represented some values that people could agree with in the body of Christ and a lifestyle and some in ways of communicating and interacting with people that were offensive to many, many people. People we're trying to reach, people we're trying to love. Okay, so this is not an easy issue, but if there's anything I can leave you with, two things. Be careful who you appear to be partnered with. Be careful what you are angry about. Right, for you and I are ambassadors of Christ. We represent him above all others. And let's just find out what Jesus has to say about all these issues and make sure that we represent him when we go to speak about them. Because in the next 4 years, we're going to have a lot of opportunities to speak about him and to clarify who he is and who he is not. Eric, go ahead and come by this. Let's pray together. Just let you get some quiet moment before the Lord. We are here, joined, gathered with the presence of God. Uniquely, he can speak things into our hearts right now. Maybe healing political wounds, navigating difficult political days is not even close to your greatest need this morning. Maybe you're here this morning and your greatest need is to be aware that at the end of your life you will stand before God and give an account and you are here today, and the love of Christ compels me to say to you, be reconciled to God today. Are you here this morning not sure that you're right with God? Are you here this morning wondering, what would it be like? What would I say in that moment if that suddenly came to me in the next week and I had to stand before God and give an account for my life? What would I say to him? Do you try and tell him that you tried to be a good person? Would you hope that you were good enough? Listen, none of those things would have ever required that God sent his son into this world. The message that Paul proclaimed in this chapter, this ministry of reconciliation, is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And the way that he didn't count them was to pick them up and place them on his son. He didn't ignore them. This is not that kind of love. It is a perfect love that in wisdom figured out a way to pay for every offense against him by placing it on his son. And this morning, you can put your faith and your trust in what Jesus Christ did in coming. There's a reason he had to come. He had to come to take our place, to take our sin, to die in our place, and to remove our penalty. Therefore, we can be reconciled to God. And so this morning, if you're here and you want to be reconciled to God, put your faith in Christ and what he's done for you. Jesus Christ, God himself, come in the flesh, lived a perfect life, taught God's ways perfectly, took your place on a cross, took your punishment to forgive you of your sins and to give you his life. If you want to be reconciled to God this morning, put your faith right there. Not in what you did, what you haven't done yet, how good of a person you've been, whether you're religious or not. Put your faith right now in Jesus Christ, what he did. Ask for his forgiveness. He gives it freely. He's already paid for it. Open your heart to him this morning. Say, Lord, I want to be reconciled to you. I want to be right with you. I want you to come fill my life. Give me that resurrection life that you speak of in the scriptures. Give it to me. I need it. God, this morning, I'm looking to you to do that. If you're here this morning and you have come to know Christ at some point in your life, but you've lost sight of the role of persuasion that you have, the ministry of reconciliation that is to be a primary feature of your life, and you have been saying things or doing things that have neglected that or damaged it or diminished it, this morning, would you turn to God in brokenness and repentance? Say, God, forgive me. I think I've put obstacles in the way of ministering your gospel to others. And the manner of my attitude or the way in which I've lived or my own observable, unrepented, sinful corruption. God, this morning, God, would you give me grace and a new start? Give me the ability to live a life that's persuasive in all these categories. To be clear about that which represents Christ in my life, my own manner of life, and my own attitude, and the policies and issues that I address and how I address them. God, make us salt in the earth in these coming days. God, make us a church, a people who bear witness to the ambassadorship that we have from Christ. I'm here representing him. I can't speak for everybody else, but this is what Jesus says about that. This is what my Lord says about that. This is what informs my life and how I live. God, make us salt and light in the world, for it desperately needs it, Lord. It is an angry, angry world. God, we don't want to be a part of anger that never produces the righteousness of God. We want to be sent by you as ambassadors with the ministry of reconciliation. Knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys.